Hello, I welcome you all in this course on steam and gas power systems. Today we will discuss different fire tube boilers. We will start with the Lancashire boiler, then we will discuss Cornish boiler, Cochran boiler and locomotive boiler. So, Lancashire boiler was widely used in earlier days and it was very popular steam boiler. Lancashire boiler. It was invented or it was fabricated in 1844 by William. William Fairbairn. In earlier days, it used to be very popular boiler. It consists of a shell, because it is a fire tube boiler. It consists of a shell. Diameter of the shell is in a range of 2 to 3 meters. Inside the shell, there are 2 fire tubes. Of same size, and the diameter of these fire tubes varies from 80 centimeter to 100 centimeter or 0.8 meter to 1.0 meter. The length of this boiler is, length of the cylinder is 7 to 8 meters. In this boiler, because the flue gases or the gases after burning the fuel passes through these tubes, this shell is filled to a certain level, is filled with the water. Rest of the space is filled with the water and steam is stored at the top. The pressure of steam can go up to 20 bar pressure in this boiler. And if I draw this is a side view. If I draw an elevation of this boiler, it is because these 2 tubes from the elevation, they will appear to be a single tube. Now, fuel is burned here in this portion. There is a grate, as I explained you earlier, a grate is a platform, it is a perforated platform or a platform having a number of rods. Okay. And in this platform, the number of rods, it is a perforated platform, and in this platform the fuel is burned, and below the grate there is an ash pit from where the ash can be removed. So, below this there is an ash pit and here the fuel is burned, and this is known as fire bridge. So, the fuel cannot go to this direction, because this is a tube and this tube does not have a uniform section at the fake end. The diameter of this tube is reduced in order to increase the velocity, and the ash is collected here. Now, if I look at the plan of this boiler, this is side view, okay. Plan will be here in first angle. Plan of the boiler. Now, in the plan of the boiler, 2 tubes will appear. I will draw tubes with different colors. Two different tubes are available. They are 5 tubes. And flue gases, they flow inside these tubes. Now, the movement of flue gases. This boiler is placed in a refractory. There is a masonry work around this boiler like this. So this is all brick work, these are refractory bricks, right. Now fuel is burnt here and the flue gases move in this direction in both the tubes. If you look from the top the flue gases, they move in this direction, right. At the end they take U-turn, from the top they take U-turn, if you look from the elevation they take U-turn and they emerge from the bottom. You are getting my point? Here there is a flue passage for the flue gases, and from elevation if you look at, there is a chimney here. There is a chimney to remove the flue gases. So there is a natural circulation, no fan is used in these boilers. So flue gases generated here, they simply leave from the, not simply leave from the chimney. After circulation in the boiler, finally they leave from the chimney. And there is a natural circulation. The movement of the flue gases is controlled by the damper. So a damper is provided here. So damper controls the flow of flue gases. So that we will discuss later. Now here let us discuss the movement of flue gases. So first the fuel is burned here, flue gases are generated, they go to this end, and at the fag end or at the last at the end, other end of this tube, they take U-turn and emerge from the bottom at the front. So moving from this side to another extreme, then coming from the bottom to the front. Now when they come to the front, these gases are bifurcated. One go to this passage, another go to this passage, because physically along the this length of the tube, these passages are physically separate from each other. Gas from in this passage cannot go here, directly here. So it has to come into the front, and the from the front it is, they are bifurcated and they move from bottom and then they move sidewise on the side flue. And finally they rejoin each other here and leave from the chimney. That is how the movement of flue gases take place. And why these arrangements are done? These arrangements are done in order to maximize the heat transmission from flue gases to the water, or okay, in order to generate steam. And 85% of the heat is transmitted in the first passage, main passage. Remaining 15% of the heat is transmitted through side passage in the bottom passage, right. So from the front, the main passage, it goes to the bottom passage. From bottom passage, it emerges from the front, bifurcate and then reunite and leave from the chimney. Now in this boiler, the steam which is collected here is saturated steam, right. And there are several mountings, there are number of mountings which are placed here. For example, I want to know the water level in the boiler. So water level indicator is provided here. Water level indicator is provided here in order to see the level of water. In order to release the steam, a steam stop valve is provided here. So there are number of accessories and the mountings on the boiler which facilitate the functioning of this boiler. Now I will show you a photograph taken from Wikipedia, the actual photograph of a used boiler. So here you can see, this is the area of grate where fuel is burned, right. And there are two flue tubes, this is the boiler shell, and you can see on the shell there are riveted joints. So because riveted joints are used here instead of welding, because riveted joints are very reliable joints, even in the aircraft for joining the components, riveting is done. So, so fuel is burned here. At the below, there is a ash pit in order to remove ash. The flue gases passes through these two tubes through this boiler, and then they, because brick masonry is not shown here, it is only iron part of the boiler is shown. Then the flue gases from the other side will travel from the bottom of the boiler, and then they will come to the front, they will bifurcate and they will go sidewise, and from the other side of the boiler they leave from the chimney. This is the total movement of flue gases inside a Lancashire boiler. Now there are certain features of Lancashire boiler which need to be mentioned here. First is the feed pipe, the water feed pipe is perforated in the boiler so that there is a uniform distribution of the water. Heating surface area per unit volume is large. In any boiler, if this is large, this is always beneficial because this increases the efficiency of the boiler. Now for this boiler, the efficiency is 65 to 70%. It's not very high. Nowadays the boilers have efficiency more than 90%. But this boiler, because it was fabricated in the first time, it was fabricated in 1844. Efficiency that time it was 65 to 70%. The steam generation rate is also important in a boiler. Steam generation rate in the boiler is approximately 8000 kg per hour. So 8000 kg per hour of steam can be generated in this boiler at 20 bar pressure. It is a stationary boiler, as I told you, because brick work has to be done. It is a stationary boiler, and classification wise it is a stationary boiler, it is a horizontal boiler, right, because the shell of the boiler is in horizontal direction and the circulation of flue gas is, or the circulation of air in the boiler is natural circulation. So there is no fan used in this boiler. Now for this boiler, the maintenance is easy. In the front you can see there is a manhole, right, for the maintenance purpose, and this valve arrangement is very important in any of the this type of boiler, because sedimentation takes place at the bottom of the boiler. So periodically this sludge has to be removed, opening a valve in order to improve the effectiveness of this boiler. Otherwise heat transmission through this portion of the boiler will be reduced. So periodically this blow off cork is open and the steam, mixture of steam, water and sludge is removed from the, or mixture of sludge and water is removed from the bottom of the boiler. This boiler is suitable where large amount of steam is required, even for the hot water purpose, in even for the, for getting the hot water, this boiler can be used. In this boiler, there are certain accessories like economizer, we will discuss in subsequent lectures, superheater and economizer. So superheater and economizer can also be installed in the boiler. A smaller version of this type of arrangement is another boiler which is known as Cornish boiler. Now Cornish boiler arrangement is more or less same, but in this boiler there is only one fire tube. So if we start with the Cornish boiler is older than the Lancashire boiler. So Cornish boiler was first time fabricated in the year 1812. So it is almost more than 200 years old. Now a smaller version of Lancashire boiler is a Cornish boiler. It was first time fabricated in 1812. By Richard Trevithick. In this boiler, there is a shell, it is also a fire tube boiler, it is a fire tube stationary boiler with natural circulation, and it has only one fire tube. And one fire tube is not concentrically fixed, but it is offset from the center. It is offset from the center, the reason being because this shell is never filled with the water. So, some space has to be left for steam, right. So, accordingly this tube is fixed so that it is almost in the middle of the water filled area. Now, in this boiler the size is comparatively smaller. The length of this boiler is 4 to 7 meters and dia of the shell is 1.25 to 1.75 meters. Now, if you look at the elevation of this boiler, it is or going to be like this. There is a fire tube. And again it has a, I mean, fuel burning, the grate for the fuel burning and the ash pit, most of the things are same. But the movement of flue gases in this boiler is different. Now, I have drawn the elevation, I will draw the plan also. Plan or elevation are more of same because there is only one tube and then here also it has a big brickwork. This is also, they are refractory bricks. Now, here in this case, the flue gases, when the flue gases go to the other side, in Lancashire boiler, they were coming from the bottom side. Now, in this boiler, Cornish boiler, they come from the side. So, the flue gases which are moving in this direction, they are bifurcated. Some of the them go to the left and some of the or almost half of the flue gases go to the right and they emerge from here. And after bifurcation and coming from left and right, they move from the bottom to the other side. So, then they move from the bottom to the, move from the bottom to the other side of the boiler, right. So, the arrangement is slightly changed in this Cornish boiler if you compare with the Lancashire boiler. Here the flue gases go to the other end, they are divided in two paths, come travel the sidewise side flue and from the side flue they go move in the, they come to the front and from front they re-enter to the bottom, right. And they do have mountings, mountings are necessary in the boiler, for example, water level indicator, pressure gauge, they are all mountings. Without mountings, the boiler cannot work. Like steam stop valve to supply steam, I am naming a few mountings. Water level indicator, which shows water level in the boiler. Steam stop, sorry, it is not here. Yes, steam stop valve, which is provided at the top of the boiler, in because we have to take, ultimately we have to take out the steam from the boiler. So, steam stop valve has to be provided, safety valves have to be provided, there are number of safety valves in the mounting. So, some safety valves are have to be provided in order to operate these boilers. So, this is how the Cornish boiler works. After the Cornish boiler, another type of popular boiler is Cochrane boiler, it is a vertical boiler. And this Cochrane boiler does not have any masonry work. So, it is a vertical boiler. Vertical fire tube boiler, or I will make a bigger sketch. Having a dome. As you can see from here also in this photograph, there is a dome of Cochrane boiler and the diameter of the Cochrane boiler is 1 to 2 meters. this diameter of the Cochran boiler. Height may vary from 3 to 6 meters. So, it depends upon the steam requirement. You want to design a bigger boiler or a small, they are available in different sizes. So, the diameter ranges from 1 to 2 meters and height 3 to 6 meters. It is a fire tube boiler, pressure can go up to 20 bar. So, pressure is 20 bar. Now, fire plays here because at the blower there is an ash pit and there is a dome. In this dome, the burning of fuel takes place. There is no joint in this dome. Burning of fuel takes place and here we can burn the fuel and there are number of fire tubes. And flue gases after burning here, they enter the fire tube. And these fire tubes later on, they join the smoke box and it is connected to chimney. I have shown only 1, 2, 3 fire tubes. There can be 5, 6, 7 depending upon the design of the boiler. Rest of the place or rest of the space is filled with water, right? And the hot gases which are emerging from here, they pass through these tubes and from the other side they leave from the chimney. Like other boilers, here also a damper is provided in order to control the movement of the flue gases and heat transmission to the water. The steam generated in this boiler is collected in this dome, right. Suppose I want to have superheated steam. What I will do, I will trap some amount of heat and this again is circulated through the flue gases. I will take certain amount of steam, saturated steam, right. I will tap a steam from here and I will circulate it, this steam pipe through the flue gases. So, again when it comes again in contact with the flue gases, the steam will become superheated. So, this technique is adopted in almost all the boilers. So, here also we can get a superheated steam. There are certain mountings like water level indicator, it is visible in the photograph also. Water level indicator, there is a smoke box, it has a door. This door in the smoke box is used for inspection purpose. Actually, this is something like vertical. So, there is a door here. So, door can be used for a inspection purpose. And an important mounting which I forgot to tell you in almost all the boilers is fusible plug. Fusible plug is provided on the tubes of the boiler, especially the fire tube boiler somewhere here. So, if there is interruption in the supply of water or the water level goes down, this fusible plug will melt, or water is overheated, then fusible plug is held, will melt, and subsequently this boiler will get extinguished. This working of the fusible plug I will explain you when I will explain you the mountings and necessities of the boiler. Okay. So, this is the functioning of Cornish boiler, sorry, this is the function of Cochran boiler. And the last one of the fire tube boiler I would like to discuss is the steam locomotive or locomotive boiler. Locomotive boiler is a horizontal boiler and it is externally fire boiler. So, if you look at the schematic of this boiler, it has, in fact, I would like to show you a photograph of this old boiler. It has a large fire space, locomotive boiler. So, it has large fire area and there is a shell, horizontal shell, and this shell consists of a number of fire tubes as shown in here in this photograph. The fuel is burned here, the flue gases they passes through the shell and on the other side there is a stack. Locomotive boilers do not have chimney because chimney is not practical. they have stacks on the other side, stack on the other side, and flue gases are removed through the stack. Stack is a very short chimney of a very short length. Since, because we don't require a chimney in a locomotive boiler, because it is a locomotive boiler. So boiler itself is moving with a very high velocity. The boiler is moving with 60 kilometers per hour or 70 kilometers per hour. So there is always a movement of air over this stack. And if you use the Bernoulli theorem, you can find a temperature drop. There is a substantial pressure drop between this grate to this stack. Due to movement of the fluid, pressure drop takes place. So chimney is not required in such boilers. And most of the things are same, mountings are same, and the fire tubes, it has a number of fire tubes in comparison to the other boilers through which the flue gases flow, right? And this boiler also, shell is not completely filled with the water, it is partially filled with the water, and top portion of the shell is filled with the steam. That is all for today, and in the next class we will start with water tube boilers.